Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy class. As we said, we are live and direct from the studios in Long Beach, and we are via telephone lines with Dr. Theodore Aranda. We're going to do the introduction, 1 minute of introduction with this wonderful radio show. Thank you for listening. We are live through LMBRoots.com radio in New York and through www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. So wait for us 1 minute as we do the introduction, and then we welcome Dr. Aranda in 1 minute. Garifuna American Heritage Foundation United proudly presents the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online. Every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx, New York, and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or handout from Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio programs will be recorded and archived on YouTube's GAHFU channel for on-demand listening. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts, in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund and the William and Flora Hewitt and the James Irvine Foundation. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we want to welcome tonight Dr. Theodore Aranda with lecture number 7 on Dügü, Garifuna Spirituality. Welcome, Dr. Aranda.
Okay,
brother. Okay. Let's go. We're ready.
Okay. You ready?
Yes.
Okay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are going to go over the ceremony of Dügü tonight again, basically because there is a great and a strong belief among so many people that Dügü is an issue of witchcraft. First of all, I'll have to confess to you that I am not sure what witchcraft is. I don't know much about witchcraft. I do know that there's evil on earth, and I do know that there are certain people that can do things and actually hurt you. I do know that. But to be able to speak about witchcraft, believe me, I am not in a position to do so because I don't know enough about witchcraft. What I do know about is I know about Dügü. I have been involved with Dügü over and over and over again. I have participated in it. I have even led it at the request of my ancestors. That's one. Number two, as I was growing up, I went to Catholic elementary school. I was trained at the St. John's College of Belize, a Catholic school. And I have been associated with the church, primarily the Catholic Church. But I have also observed and attended services with various other kinds of churches, not kinds of churches, but various other churches. I have been into Methodist, I have been into Anglican, I have even been to non-Christian services. And I've watched what people do. I have done research into what those people believe and what they practice. But if you know the good, and that's a very first issue that you have to sort of agree to, at least for tonight. If you know the good, then you will understand what I'm saying. Number two, if you know your church, you can also understand what I am saying. because the first statement I'm going to make, and this is not simply a statement I take lightly, again, because I said to you that I have dealt with the rule, I have been involved in it, and I have also, I was an altar boy when I was young and growing up. I know my Catholic Church quite well. I am not talking the doctrines and all of those doctrines, because that's a different subject matter. That's mostly philosophy. But religions, the churches, and the practices in churches are usually based on philosophical concepts, but we are not going to go into that because that's quite complex and quite difficult. But we are going to go into the Dügü itself, and we are going to compare and contrast with the churches, basically because we all believe or would not accept the fact that churches and the church groups are witchcraft. I don't think any of us would say that a church, let's say the Catholic Church, the Methodist Church, or what we would want to believe that any of the major churches on earth and the major religion on earth is a matter of witchcraft. One thing that we all understand is that churches and the religious services encompass or embody about 6 or 7 items at the same time. But what we are going to do tonight is sort of break those, participation, or break those kind of a service, break those kind of adorations into pieces so that at least we can understand them well. Number two, very, very important. And I say this now and I say it again. If you know your church, your religion, and if you know the good, you can clearly and easily see that our churches and our services or religious practices originate in the good. That's where it comes from. But I'm going to make a statement here and now, and I will come back to it a little later, that if we know the Dügü to be the origin of our present churches, if we know that the Dügü enables us to recognize our church, the services in our church, in something else, there wouldn't be much of a problem. But unfortunately, the fact that Dügü itself has been disconnected from its development, in other words, from its evolution. What has happened is that the evolution of Dügü has been disconnected from the origin Dügü, so that the present churches today and the present services that we do to God today are not recognized to be from the very origin that it came from. So that very many of us, most of us, cannot even understand and recognize the connections. I want you to understand that piece. Let me give you a very small example. And this example is about human beings. You take a little child, a little baby preferably, an infant, let's say 2, 3 days or 4 days old or a month old child, and you see an old man, let's say 100 years old or 105 years old, there is a possibility, as a matter of fact, too many of us will not be very conscious of the fact that this old man, 105 years old, or whatever the age he has, was once an infant, like this little child in the German that we are talking about, say 3, 4, 5 days or a month or so. Basically because during the lifetime, they have evolved, they have changed, they have grown up, and the various other factors happen. Some factors are physical, some factors are psychological, but nonetheless, these are factors that have modified and changed this little child into this old man. I want to make that clear so that at least I can come back to it a little later. If therefore you can understand that the oldest of us, however old the person may be, was once a baby, was once born, then we can understand that this man, however old is he, evolved from that little child or from that little baby. Now, when I say, therefore, that Dügü is the origin of our cultural and spiritual manifestations, we need to understand that piece. One is the origin. It started here. But they evolve. When I say evolve, they change. Let's say, for instance, if you were to go to, say, St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, and you go to a very little, small, little church in a village, you wouldn't believe that they are basically the same. You would want to believe that the basilica over there is the basilica, and this little church here is just a little hut. So I repeat, Dügü is the clearest. And I repeat this, Dügü is the clearest and the oldest form, as well as is the origin of the cultural and the spiritual manifestation of humankind. Let's take these pieces, therefore, these manifestations, and work around with them. Let's put it this way, the first one. Church service. You will find me using the word mass every now and then, because that's my tradition. You will find that mass is a petition to the Almighty God. It's not a matter of whether you believe in God or not. It's a matter of the fact that the people who practice and give mass or do the mass, do it to the one and only Almighty God that they know. The mass, therefore, the religious service that they are giving is not for the pagan to start condemning. He is not the one to be able to clarify and explain what that mass is about. It's the practitioners of the mass. The priest, the bishop, the church, etc., are the ones who explain it to you as to what it is. You don't come out from the bushes to tell them that what they are doing is witchcraft because you don't understand it. You have to understand the mass first before you can understand that it is a petition. So is the Dügü. Both are petitions to the Almighty God, except that Dügü includes the ancestors. So Dügü is a petition to the one and only Almighty God and our ancestors. The mass would not say or agree or do or mention the ancestors first and foremost, in spite of the fact that very many of the spirituality of the Mass goes back to the activities, teachings, lifestyle, and examples of former people. And that's what we call saints. We like to speak of a saint this, saint the other. We like to speak about the apparition of God to this holy man or that holy woman. We like to speak about the apparition or participation or speaking or communication of God to other humankind and human beings. That is one side of it. In other words, therefore, too often, or not too often, when we need something that we cannot achieve ourselves, that we cannot do ourselves, we usually ask God to assist us with it, or we pray for it, or we ask divine intervention. These are words that we can use freely because they are indeed one and the same thing. Now, from once, let's come to the human side of this petition I'm speaking about right now. When a child is at home and he needs something or wants something, the child usually goes to his parents to ask for some money to buy what he wants to do, what he wants to buy. When he wants some ice cream, he goes to mom or dad for a dollar or two or whatever the price of the ice cream is, because he can't buy it out of his own pocket. He doesn't have the money. So he seeks and he petitions and he asks his parents for the money to buy the thing that he wants to buy. So Mass, first and foremost, Dügü, first and foremost, is a petition. Number two, Dügü is an act of healing. Healing. And we seek that healing from the one and only God, as well as from our ancestors. That's what Dügü is. It's an act of petition for healing from the one and almighty God, as well as from our ancestors. Now let's take a little look at that and see how one compares with the other. Every child at home, one time or the other, becomes a little sick, ill, or whatever it is. The parents today have access to physicians. So you take the child to a physician. And very many times at home, Dr. Mom is going to take a child and take care of a child. When he scrapes his knee or scratches his, whatever, hits his forehead or bumps his forehead and gets a little bruise, he comes screaming to Mom. And Mom is the one who goes and rub that little bruise, sometimes with a kiss, and you actually feel better. All of us go through that somewhere along the line. The same goes to Dügü. Dügü is an act of healing by and from the Almighty God, as well as from our ancestors. With healing, therefore, at home, a common thing at home, if you cut yourself, you usually wash it, clean it, etc., and you put some medication on it. We do that at all times. Would we want to call that witchcraft? Or do we understand it to be an act of healing? The same goes for the Dügü. When you go to, when you ask Almighty God to help us because we are ill or whatever, when we ask our ancestors to please help us get well, to cure us, to recover from whatever is wrong with us, is that an act of witchcraft? Number three, atonement. Atonement. Atonement means reconciliation. Reconciliation. Making amends. To make up with somebody that you have already offended. Let's say at home it's a very common thing between brothers and sisters, mother and father, father and husband and wife. That every time, if you do something that bothers or offends your wife, you go back to her and ask for, tell her that you're sorry about it, so that we could reconcile to get back to the decent life that we have been trying to build at home. The same thing, when we do wrong, or when we commit wrong against a brother, against another human being, we like to go back to them and ask them for forgiveness and say, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to. I didn't mean it that way. That's not what I wanted to do. In other words, we try to make amends and we try to seek reconciliation. When we do something wrong at home and our mother is upset or father is upset, brother and sisters are upset, and we know that we were the wrong, we were the ones who are culpable, we normally go back to them and say, I'm sorry, can you get back to being a brother and sister? And usually right after that we are running around the place over and over again like we usually do. So atonement is another. Let's go back. The first one was petition. The second one is healing. And the third one is atonement. All of those are done in Dügü. All of those are done in the house, at home. All of those are done in the religious groups that we are members of. Number four, thanksgiving. A mass is an act of thanksgiving. That is, we thank God, or whatever the name we give our God is, for the gifts that He has given us. And we show gratefulness for what we have indeed received. We say thank you for favors that we receive. All of those are thankfulness. We take that to the church and we are forever praising God or thanking God for the favors and the blessings and the goodness that He showers down on us. As a matter of fact, even when we offend Him, even as we offend Him, and we do so over and over and over and over, sometimes stupidly and sometimes negligently and sometimes by mistake, the same thing happens in the Dügü. Every now and then we are going to do the wrong thing, we are going to say the wrong thing, and we are going to commit some kind of a silliness. And when you commit those silliness, we usually go back to our ancestors, we go back to God seeking forgiveness and seeking the recovery and the return to the favorable way in which we have been living, or at least try to live. The next one that we are going to put on point tonight is praise. In the Dügü, that is what we do. We praise the one and the Almighty God, and we praise our ancestors because we recognize the good that they have done or that they are capable of doing, and the good that they would like us to be. We express worship. In other words, in the case of God, we worship our God. We do homage. We show appreciation and admiration. And the same thing with our ancestors and God. In the Dügü, we praise God and we praise our ancestors. And we always say that we want to continue that life with God as well as with our ancestors. The other one that we want to mention tonight is offerings. This is where so many people seem to get stuck and cannot quite understand. Offerings. We make offerings to our Almighty God as well as to our ancestors. We do. In the church, and I know that this happens in every single church, we give collections in the church, or we make offers to the church for this or the other. Sometimes we, if the church is going to be built, we offer blocks, or we offer cash, or we offer labor, or we offer a piece of land for the construction of the church. And whatever it is that is required to build this church, we normally go to our church members and seek support, seek material, funds, labor, or skill to build it, to build this structure. The same thing with Dügü. Dügü requires offering. The thing about Dügü that very many times we don't quite understand, seemingly, is Dügü is one of the biggest religious celebrations there is, excepting a pilgrimage. Pilgrimage simply means, let's say, for instance, those who would want to make a pilgrimage from here to the Basilica of Rome, or to Jerusalem, or they're going to the Mecca, or they're going to any other place like that. They usually imply or try to do things so that at least they can get there. And they bring along some offerings, and they bring along what they want to do. And to do that, they normally do or go through an act of cleansing. It's not so common anymore, but I do remember before you go for Holy Communion in the Catholic Church, you needed to confess. You needed to go to confession. From the looks of it, I don't know if it is still required, but it's not as common as it used to be. And for you to be forgiven your sins, so to speak, you have to do a few things, like say this or that prayer so many times, not to continue committing the thing that you are going to confession for. But the point here is that you are required to make some kind of offering. Now, offering comes in different ways, very many different ways. Let's go back and repeat some of those things that we have pointed out, so that at least we can continue. We spoke about petition. We spoke about healing. We spoke about atonement. We spoke about thanksgiving. Now let's take another look at thanksgiving. Thanksgiving simply means showing gratitude to God for the things that He has bestowed upon us. Sometimes thanksgiving is in form of just a small contribution. But in the United States of America, there is a holiday which is usually the last Thursday of November, I think it is, if I remember well.
Yes.
Last Thursday of November. And it's a public and a national holiday. And that holiday is primarily thanksgiving to God for the bounties that He has laid down upon this United States of America. And up to today, it's there. It started from the fruit of the farm. It started there. When they would have a bountiful harvest, they would take some of their produce to the church or to a gathering. Sometimes they share it among themselves. Sometimes they sell it so that they can collect money to give it to the church. But the point is, it's a thanksgiving for the bountiful gifts that God has given us. And in the United States, the example is a fantastic one, because it's not simply one in his own church. It's not simply one at home. But it's a national day. And it becomes a holiday. And there are a lot of preparations for it. Only that today we have, business has pushed it so far, that Thanksgiving Day is one of the most profitable business day or week in business of the United States, in the commerce of the United States. Because there is pre-Thanksgiving sale, that there is a sale on that day, and there is sale afterwards. Businessmen make a heck of a lot of money out of it. But it still remains, or at least it is, the idea behind it is thanksgiving to the Almighty God for the bounties that He has bestowed upon us. And the United States has pushed it to the extreme of making it a national holiday, while most other nations do not quite do it that way. Dügü is another one. The national holiday of the United States is very big. So is the Dügü. Dügü requires a whole year in preparation. And that whole year is, you prepare for this, you prepare for all sorts of things. Members from all over the world, for that matter, will come to be a part of the Dügü. If there's a Dügü here in Belize, for instance, one of the most common thing is that people from the United States, if the people from the United States, from Honduras, from as far as Europe, will come for that celebration, so that they are part of it, and they are doing that in thanksgiving to their ancestors. So, indeed, thanksgiving is one of the major features of gratitude to God for what He has done for us. The other one that we have to touch is sacrifice. Sacrifice. We do make sacrifice for God's sake as well as for our ancestors. And this sacrifice entails a lot of things. A lot of things. Sometimes you have to buy your clothing, your dress appropriately for that service. Just like we do very many times, I'm going to buy my dress for Christmas. Or I'm going to buy my dress for my wedding. Or I'm going to buy my dress for this gathering, family gathering. And it really requires very many times big expenses. Wedding is very expensive. So is the good. So is a national celebration of Thanksgiving. So sacrifice is one of it, and God rewards sacrifice. Whenever you make sacrifice to God for this or for the other, you always get a reward for it, or at least most religious people believe that there is a reward attached to it. So that when you do the right thing, or when you do the correct thing, so to speak, there is a reward for your sacrifice. And very many people, very many times, do not even look at the sacrifice anymore. It just is a habit with them to do it. Let's take another example to show that. In the church, and up to now I see it so many times among the Protestant churches, there is something called tithing. Tithing is supposed to be one-tenth of your earnings that you're supposed to give to your church. You give that money to the church so that the church can indeed continue doing the things, continue spreading the words of the gospel or whatever belief you have. The thing being that you are doing it to forward or to advance the cause of the church or of God in that matter, for that matter, because you believe that your church is linked to and associated with God. And the services that you do, whether you do it every day or Sunday or whatever, is towards that end. And you do sightings. In the church itself, inside the church, that is, there is what we call a collection from the congregation. In the Catholic Church, a basket will come around, and you're supposed to give whatever you can afford, but very many times people do make sacrifice to give a little more than they possibly would afford. So whether it's in collection, or it's in tithing, or in giving something to the church or to your congregation for what we call improvement of that congregation, then there is what we would call the Holy Reunion. Holy Reunion usually would mean that people come together to celebrate a specific occasion that they consider holy. And these celebrations, as I said to you, there is a holy reunion. That's one. When there is a special mass, let's say anniversary of the death of somebody within the family, or marriage or wedding within the family, or the burial of a member of the family. All of those are reunions, which means that people come from various and distant lands to witness or to be a part of that occasion. All of these things are done within the churches, within the congregations of churches, within the families. The same thing goes for Dügü. Dügü being a big celebration, with the preparation of at least a year towards it. People come from long distances. People make contributions. They make preparations. And they come to be a part of it. They do that for the God they do that for their ancestors. Okay? Then, we are going to leave that for a while, and I'll come back to it in a short while, because the question I'm going to ask, well, we have mentioned all of these things, that we have mentioned petition, healing, atonement, thanksgiving, praise, offering, sacrifice, holy reunion, tithing, and collection and congregation. We have mentioned all of those. Those are part of the celebrations within the church or activities within the church or within the group. Now let's leave that for a while and let's go to specific occasions when we actually select to do things specifically for a specific cause. There are two occasions when the living goes into petition and atonement for the dead. Let me repeat that. There are two occasions when the living goes into specific petition and specific atonement for the sake of the recent of the dead. When the death is recent, and usually before the burial, that is before the interment of the body, the living members of the family, particularly the living members of the family, go into a prayer session petitioning atonement for the deceased. By that I mean they go to where the dead body is and they pray for the relief, for the routing, for the way, for the path of the dead to be clear so that the deceased can find a straight and a good and a decent road to safety. Now we are talking of the first of the sessions. That session is what we in Garifuna call reserve. Some other people nowadays call it prayer sessions, and other people just call it nine nights, etc., or something like that. But the point here is this: that when the person dies, shortly after he dies, there is this service, as we said, reserve is one. But the most significant thing about it is that the living come to pray, and they usually use the negative confessions. Negative confessions are the 42 statements made by a person to prove or to show that he was a good person, that his life was clean, and that he deserves to go to heaven. Now, let's go to negative confessions and see just a few statements from it. In the Ten Commandments, we say, I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt not have strange gods before me. That's one of them. Number two is, love thy neighbor as thyself. That's another one. Those are commandments now. And another one is, honor thy father and thy mother. Another one is, thou shalt not steal. Another, thou shalt not kill, etc. There are ten of them. Those are the negative concerns. Those are the Ten Commandments. And all of those Ten Commandments come from the negative confession. The thing about the Ten Commandments is not that it's different, but it's rather comes in a different fashion. The fashion is basically this: thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill. That's the part of the Ten Commandments. In the negative confessions, since the dead is dead, what you say, or the negative commandments would be, I did not kill. So you use that, and in other words, you are praying in the name of the dead, and you use it the way he would have said it when he was alive. In other words, you are going to sum up his life, if you want to put it that way, and you are going to say, I did not kill. I honored my father and my mother. I loved my neighbor. I did not wantonly kill animals or kill people or whatever. In other words, while the Ten Commandments would say, thou shalt not, the negative confession says, I did not. So during this research thing, what the congregation or what the grouping is, I mean what the group does, is to ask God to open the path for him, because he did not, or he is saying, and he would have said that he did not commit this or that wrong. So that when he says, I did not kill, at least that's one sin he did not commit, or one offense that he did not commit. Is exact same, not exact same thing, but thou shalt not kill. The difference between the Ten Commandments and the negative confession is that in the negative confession is the person himself saying that he did not do this wrong. He is the one saying that for himself. I did not kill. I did not steal. I did not take the name of the gods in vain. While in Ten Commandments, it is, thou shalt not. In other words, the instructions come from elsewhere other than you. That's why the negative confessions or confessions are positive. That's why they are moral. Because you have taken it upon yourself, or you have declared that you did not kill this, and it is you who chose not to kill, not because an instruction or an order was given to you, not because you did punish, but because you yourself have chosen to live a decent life. That's the effect and the factor of the negative confessions. It's you personally who assumes the responsibility, assumes that you embrace that power, you embrace that authority unto yourself to do the right thing and to live a moral life. That's what the negative confessions are strong for. While the Ten Commandments is an instruction, whether from the church or from elsewhere, some people want to believe in Moses, but the point here is this, it is thou shalt not. Instruction given to you not to do this and not to do that. But negative confessions were the first, long, long before the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments were drawn from the negative confessions. That's why, therefore, I said at the very outset that Dügü, that the African morality is older than any of the other things that we now do today. It's from there that we got what we are doing now. But if and when you don't recognize what was done by the Africans, what was done by the black people in those days, and you are familiar only with the Ten Commandments, you are going to attribute that Ten Commandments to Rome. But it didn't begin with Rome. It began with the blacks, way, way back. So that is one, that is the research. Research, therefore, is primarily the living pleading for the dead in the fashion in which the dead would have done it. In other words, what I'm saying is, instead of saying, he was a good man, I would say, I was a good man, and I'm speaking for him when I say that. I was a good man. I didn't kill. So that's a big, big difference there. Now, knowing therefore, as I said a little earlier, knowing therefore that Dügü is the origin of the present churches, and that it is the origin of the services of today, as long as we can recognize that, we can then see and recognize the connection between the two. And we can then see and understand why and how this that we have today came from something much, much older, way, way back. It is important that we do that because of the fact that very many times we lose a good amount of our morality because of the fact that we do not understand, or neither do we remember how this thing was supposed to be. Let's go back to the example I told you about a person saying that, a person saying that he did not kill, and going back to the commandments, which says thou shalt not kill. Very many people will not do wrong simply because they are afraid of going to jail. Very many people will not steal because they are afraid to be caught. Very many people will not kill simply because they don't want to face judgment on the hangman's rope or something like that. That is the law. However, the negative confession were not the law as such. It was a breeding, it was a teaching, it was a moral principle that you are taught from in everyday life, at home, on the street, in school, in the church, or wherever you are. So that is why it is more moral, it's stronger. It is much, much better in a certain way. That out of you comes the fact of not wanting to kill because it is wrong. Whatever your reason for it being wrong, but it is out of you that it comes. It's not something that is imposed upon you because you'll be jailed, or you'll be hung, or you'll be punished, or you'll be this, or you'll be the other. If, therefore, we can understand that the Dügü is the origin of all of these teachings, all of these moral teachings, we can quite easily understand how stronger they were, and that we are indeed losing much of what we could be if it were just something taught to us at home or in the church or wherever. However, and unfortunately, because Dügü, that is the origin of this whole thing, has been disconnected from the way it evolved. In other words, what we see is the final outcome, not what it comes from. If we could really just understand that the present churches today and the services are results and they originate in the Dügü, we could not, under any circumstance, call Dügü witchcraft. Because let me ask you now, and let's go to the questions that I would like you to answer. You don't need to answer because I wouldn't hear you anyway. But let's go to it. Is petitioning God to give us his blessing witchcraft? That's Dügü. Dügü is a petition. The church we go to is a petition. When we ask for atonement, forgiveness, making up with our friends and colleagues and the world itself, is that witchcraft? But that's what Dügü is, atonement. And that's what our religious services and groupings are. When we give thanks for the blessing that we have, Is that witchcraft? Now, if you understood that to be a part of the Dügü, would you want to say to me that Dügü is witchcraft? But when you do it in the church, when you give a tithing, it is not a witchcraft anymore. Now, the thing here is basically this. If you understand it, you wouldn't say at all, and you wouldn't attempt to say that witchcraft or that Dügü is witchcraft. Because whether you celebrate Thanksgiving, give praise and offerings and the sacrifice, you go to holy reunions, you do tithings and the collection from your congregation, is that witchcraft? Dügü does exactly the same thing. And the significance of Dügü, above all of this that I'm giving you now, is that it was the beginning. It was there that it began. What we have today is a continuation of what was. What we have today is evolution, is the best word for it, but I don't know if that's a very clear word to many, many people. In other words, it started out there and it continues. It is the same thing, maybe in a little different way of doing it. It's just like when I was a little kid, I used to see people collect wood and do farming, fire hut outside to cook the food. Today we have a stove inside the house. Are you telling me that the stove really is not exactly a fire hut in the sense that it cooks your food? It is the same thing. The only thing is that the way we do it has changed a little. Not the thing itself. We still eat. That is, we put food in our mouth, chew and swallow. That's what eating is. It was, is, and will ever be. Excepting for nowadays, when you are too sick and you cannot chew, you can be fed through the veins. But it's the same thing. It's putting nutrition into your body. Evolution is very, very significant to understand. You need to understand where your church is, but you need to understand where it came from. You need to understand what you are doing now in any elaborate way you do it, shiny clothing, vessels and the shiny buildings, etc., as against those that were in those days. But those were beautiful churches of then. So I hope at least I've helped in pointing out that Dügü is not witchcraft. Neither are our churches, neither are our religious groups. We end here today and we have something to do for next week. So run. Yes, if you have any questions, please raise them. And if there's anybody who would like to ask a question, I'm willing to listen.
We have a question from a listener in Texas, and there was a couple of comments that followed up because I posted the question on the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Facebook page. And here is the original question. It says, why are we now allowing outsiders to our sacred rituals to subsequently having them demonizing our spirituality?
That's a beautiful one. I love that one.
Yes.
The thing is this, and I have gotten into that case over and over again. Rani, the whole thing is this. Our spirituality is starting to be recognized more and more.
Yes.
But there are still a lot of questions around it, not because of the fact that it's right or wrong, but because they want to know what it is. And because of the fact that some of us have been saying, and we continue saying, that what we have today, let's say the mass, the services, etc., sprang from that. But the view was not exactly an open thing, especially what happens inside the ghouli. Remember we spoke about the ghouli some time ago.
Yes.
Some of that is not exactly wide open to the public. That would require a lot of discussion to be able to and make that understood. The Garifuna people do not want the sacred portion of the service and the sacrifice to be for the public, because it is between you, the family or whatever, and the ancestors and the God. It's not a quote a public thing. There is a portion of it that is public, all right. There are portions of it, but there are certain portions of it that is quite secret. Very much the same thing. The Jews learned that from the Africans, learned that from the Egyptians. What we call tabernacle. Tabernacle would be the sacred place. And there is another expression in English, in Latin, sanctorum, sanctus sanctorum, the holy of the holies. That's never very, very wide open. So the Garifuna would have to sort of recognize now that they need to maintain some privacy in their religion and in their practices if they choose to.
Okay.
That's no longer an attack on religion. That's no longer an attack on the Garifuna. It simply is that very many people would like to know what goes on in there.
Okay, now, after the question, there was another question. Actually, there was two answers to that question.
Yes.
And one is a comment, one is a rebuttal. This is from Eva, listening in La Buga, Livingston. She says, outsiders, there are insiders. For example, pure Garifuna blooded Garifuna people in Livingston who demonize the Garifuna spirituality. There is a church full of them, and that is what they preach to the congregation. One time, they called me the gringa, right? I was telling a woman how much I like certain songs from the Garifuna ceremony. She was referring to the Dügü. Then the lady looked at me in horror and gasped, and saying that they were songs of the devil.
Yes. Ronnie, you'll find people like that. There are those who don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I said to you some time ago, if they don't understand it, how can you condemn something that you don't quite know about? And they pick the silliest of statement to sort of demonize or to condemn the whole. That's very, very common. Believe me, there is. Just like people, there are quite a few people today who still believe that Christopher Columbus discovered the Americas. So are those people.
I have another question. This one is very nice. I really like this one. It says, can you ask Dr. Aranda, what is the original religion of the Garifuna people? Because Catholicism was introduced to the Garifuna people later in life by the Spanish and by the English people.
To be honest with you, Ron, as one of the trips I'm going to make to back to Africa, I'm going to go to Gambia. Gambia is a place where there are still Mandinka people. But again, you can't say Africa. Africa is a huge continent, believe me. It is a huge continent. There are very, very many types of kinds of religion there. What the only thing I think we can do is more or less look at what we have now, that is our Dügü and the rest of them, and see where it relates and how it connects to those, to what they practice over there. Now, what the religion of the Garifuna people were, remember, we became Garifuna people after we crossed the Atlantic. Now, we need to go back there to where we were before we crossed the Atlantic to see what the people there still do. And I intend to make that trip. I was hoping to do it this year, but I'm not too sure that we'll do it this year. But we will go back just so that we could sort of develop a tie and a link with our brothers and sisters who are still on the other side of the Atlantic.
Excellent.
But to be honest, I can't answer the question. I need to go there because I would like to see the rituals that they do, the dancing that they do, the ceremonies that they do, whether they do a hammer or not. That's the kind of thing I really would like to know. And I am going to be meeting with the Gambians sometime next week, as a matter of fact, in New York, and we are going to raise some of those questions and see if there is a way of getting an answer to those questions, but not an answer in the sense of just somebody just telling you what happened, but you can go there, you see it yourself, observe it, and see whether or not you can see the connection for yourself.
Thank you so much, Surusia. It's been a wonderful lecture again. And next week, don't forget to tune in for lecture number 8. That will be the last of the lecture for session 1 of Garifuna History and a little bit of Garifuna spirituality from Dr. Theodore Aranda. So send your questions, please. Send your comments via our Facebook page, which is the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online. Also, you can send your questions via text 323-898-6841. Once again, 323-898-6841. If you want to text your questions, also via email to GarifunaHeritageFoundation@yahoo.com. Thank you, Surusia Buitegunyo, and we'll see you next Wednesday, sir.
Le mego di mas wadu na web.
All right, Selemi.
Reni.
Ayo.
Selemi.
Okay.
Ayo.
Ladies and gentlemen, this has been another wonderful lecture offered by Dr. Theodore Aranda and brought to you by the Alliance for Garifuna, for Alliance for the Traditional Arts, ACTA, A-C-T-A, ACTA, Alliance for California Traditional Arts. Thank you so much. And also, I want to thank all of our listeners who were tuned in tonight. We are going to play the outro for the show, and then we're going to go to New York with Budari Palacios with the report of what's going on in the Garifuna community of New York, one of the largest outside of Central America. ¿Qué motia?
Hola, mi celuma. Hola, mi celumama.
On behalf of Garifuna American Heritage Foundation United, we thank you for joining us tonight to the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online. Don't forget, tune in every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time and 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or the handout from our Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio shows are recorded or archived for your online demand. So you can find it on YouTube's GAHFU channel anytime 24/7. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts, in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund, the William and Flora Hewitt, and the James Irvine Foundation.
All right, nice. Vamos a ir con Budari Palacio en un par de minutos. Nada más vamos a poner un comercial de...